Thank you for this introduction. That's a real pleasure for me to have all of you here. And I'm Andrey Malykhanov, and I'm going to present to you our project, which we did with my colleague Vitaly Chernenko, who is also here today. I'm going to be talking about mining. And specifically, I'm going to be talking about mining simulation tool to support planning and operational improvements. So first of all, we'll see what the underground mining looks like. After that, we'll try to understand why underground mining is a complex system. Underground mine is a complex system. We'll try to put ourselves in the shoes of mine planners and see how the simulation can be useful for them. And finally, I will demonstrate the system on an example of two cases. So let's get started. Typical underground mining process includes several relatively simple steps to get the ore to the surface. First, we drill the blast holes, put explosives in there, then we do the blast clean, which is just take the ore out of the stopes with scoop trams and dump trucks. Then we haul the ore, which is just deliver the ore to the point of oisting. Then we oist it, and we're done. Ore is on the surface. But in reality, underground mine is a little bit more complex system where no subsystem is isolated, and there are a lot of interdependencies. A typical example of the interdependency is evacuation for the time of blast. So the distance of evacuation is always dependent on the mine layout and is different from time to time, from blast to blast. And the time needed to do this evacuation is also different for every time. Once we've done the blast, we need to clean the ore from stopes, and again, cycle times of dump trucks and scoop trams is never constant. Because of congestions in the narrow part of the mine, and queuing in front of the ore passes, etc., the poor quality of the ground in some selected areas, etc. So, and ore passes themselves here are also can also sometimes be overflown, and everything is stopped. If the train below is late, for example, the ore pass gets overflown and everything is stopped. And the conveyor system is probably the best example of interdependencies, because conveyor belts collect the ore from throughout the mine and take the ore to the oist. And once conveyors gets filled, or bunker get filled at one part of the system, this constraint can be propagated throughout the mine and stop the work, I don't know, thousands of meters away. So, I think it's clear that there are a lot of overlapping activities, interactions between equipment units, changing cycle times, and complexities of our other types in underground mines. But let's put ourselves in the shoes of mine planners who have to take decisions and make commitments. They have to determine what the system capacity is. They have to test feasibility of mine plans, evaluate our outcome of different types of operational improvements, quantify return on investment, etc. So what do they do? Traditionally, they make assumptions. I put just several examples of those assumptions in there. For example, the average haulage distance is the assumption which is never close to the reality, because the cycle time of haulage is different from point to point, from time to time, etc., because it's influenced by that many parameters that nobody can control. The average dump time, again, if the system gets overflown or there are queues in front of the ore passes, etc., the dump time changes. And the last one is one of my favorite. That is the percentage of the time conveyor is stopped due to overflow. That's really, in real mind, they use it in their planning practices. So that's also never constant, and cannot be specified with just a single number. I think in this audience, it will not be surprised if I say that simulation allows us to simulate everything directly and get rid of most of the assumptions. Of course, to a certain extent, which is limited by granularity of the model, But still, simulation is helpful here for evident reasons. But as we do, as we build this complex model, and which considers thousands of parameters and different types of equipment, etc., everything requires data. And this is too much data that has to be collected first, then maintained, updated, etc. For example, take the mine layout. It changes daily as we advance through the stopes. And does it mean that it's too complex for mine planners to use simulation? So that's kind of a challenge that we faced during our projects. And the idea we came up with is we integrated AnyLogic model with a domain-specific user interface to get our mining simulation tool. This user interface is a tool which allows mine planners to manage the scenarios most of the time in a point-and-click manner. I will demo it later. And all the data input is protected and protected against human errors. And on top of that, this domain-specific tool can be integrated with enterprise asset management systems or even geological system to import the mine plans, etc. So we combined the AnyLogic simulation and this domain-specific user interface to get our mining simulation tool. And I'm going to demonstrate the tool to you now on the example of two real business cases. Let's look at the case number one. It's about potash mine. It's a big one that has eight by 8 kilometers, that's just 5 by 5 miles in size. The ore is mined on 3 underground levels, and they have 21 of kilometer of conveyor belts taking the ore through the system to the skip hoist. And the ore is mined in this mine with the borers. It's one of them is shown here, and the borer continuously crushes the ore and dumps the crushed ore to its own local buffer. Then the ore is dumped to the dump truck, which makes runs between borer and ore pass where it dumps the ore. And when the dump truck starts dumping the ore to the ore pass, firstly, everything goes well because the capacity of the ore pass is 3 tons, but a dump truck carries about 22 tons of ore. So after the third ton, the dumping speed gets dependent on the current load of conveyor system underneath the ore pass. So evidently constrained. And our idea was, and the mine planner's idea was, add a buffer between dump trucks and ore passes. So in this 2B scenario, or the future scenario, which is shown here with the green, we just add very simple equipment, which looks like close to the regular trucks, which is called mobile ore loaders, or MOLs, which is the buffer between dump truck and ore pass. So the dump truck quickly dumps the ore to this MOL, and it starts then dumping it further to the ore pass and conveyor system, and dump truck quickly returns back to the borer. So we add the buffering capacity and hope for less dump trucks cycle time. And the question that mine planners ask is, can we remove one borer and add, if we have 5 MOLs for our mine, let's say for next month, can we remove one borer and still keep the production volume? And why removing the borer is so important? Because it carries a lot of OPEX. It needs a lot of maintenance team inside there in mine. It's a very complex system. So the less borers we have in the mine, the better. Probably will be more economically efficient. So that was the question. And the further more specific questions are, which exactly borer to remove, and which and where to send those 5 MOLs to. So to approach these questions with a simulation, let's first consider the simple system of borer plus dump truck. This system has its own internal constraints, like own performance of the borer, maintenance, time needed to do maintenance, regular roof bolting. Again, we have to stop the process to do this roof bolting, etc. And it has only one external constraint, which is load of the conveyor system at the time and place of dumping the ore. And what we were trying to do with the MOLs is to get rid of this external constraint, right? So our idea is how much will each borer produce if we remove its external constraints? So to what extent each borer is constrained with its own internal constraint? We don't know. Let's do the experimentation. And let's set the volume of the ore pass to infinity and see what happens. And what happens is the results are shown here. There are a lot of numbers, but don't worry, I will comment on that. So I have the comparison here of two scenarios, which is the first one, in the first column is as-is production of tones per month, and the second one is unconstrained production of tones when we remove the external constraint completely, and I've sorted all the borers down by relative production increase in an unconstrained scenario compared to as-is scenario or constrained scenario. So what we can see here is those three borers, number 150, 105, and 65, are most constrained by their internal constraints. So they're probably the worst candidates to be working with MOLs because the MOLs are there to remove external constraints. So these are the candidates for removal from the mine. And now let's move from the numbers to the to some entertainment. That's how the how our model looks like. The red stuff moving there is the flows of ore moving through conveyor system from the borers to the skip hoist. And when the conveyor stopped, it's highlighted with the light red color, and we can navigate between the borers and see them working. And this guy moving between the borer and ore pass is our dump truck. And we can speed up the simulation. We can actually see that the two borers are working simultaneously. We have actually 20 of them plus some of them working at very different part of the mine. So the continuous flows of ores move through the system, and sometimes it gets stopped. And if we speed up the simulation, we can see that over a month they do a considerable amount of work in advancing through the stopes. So that was the first demonstration. And remember that we wanted to determine which exactly borer to remove. We did the experimentation by of taking out each one of them and see that removing borer number 65 will allow us to get higher production volume. So this one should be removed. And further we had to determine where to send the five MOLs that we have because we can't buy all of them at the same time. So where do we send them? For the next month, we had to do about a dozen of experiments. So, but to cut a long story short, this is already the results of the final experiment, which says that if we send the MOLs to borers number 12, 82, 99, 11, 89, we will be able to get 873,000, almost 873,000 tons of ore production, which is only 1.02% less than in our as-is scenario with 20 borers. So the bottom line is, yes, if we have five MOLs, we can get rid of one borer and experience less operational expenditure and have and stay with almost the same production. So that was the first case. The second case is about nickel mine. I think you remember the picture I've showed you at the beginning of this presentation. And in this case, we are going to be focused on stope works. The stope works, I've highlighted it with this dashed line here. So what happens in the stopes is actually this cycle. First, we drill the blast holes, put explosives in there. Then we do the blast. Then we clean the ore that just we take out the ore with the scoop trams and dump trucks down, further down to conveyor system. And then we start over. The main constraint or the main limitation here is that all blasts for evident safety reasons All blasts are done at the same time throughout the mine 2 times a day. And nobody waits for drilling teams to finish. If drilling is not finished, the blast is skipped, and the capacity of everybody and all the equipment is probably lost. And the same thing is about the cleaning. If cleaning team is not finished with the stope, it still has to evacuate for the blast time, and we also lose the capacity of, or we'll also lose the production of ore. And the main question here is how deep we should drill the blast holes. So how deep they should be. And the trade-off is the following. The deeper we drill the blast holes, the more rock is crushed per blast, evident. And less jumbo drills, so this equipment that makes the holes, blast holes, is called jumbo drill sometime. And less jumbo drills time is lost due to moving and due to setups. Obviously, we are getting more efficient, especially in terms of time. But as no cycle time is constant, we have higher risk of skipping the blast, and vice versa. If we have shorter blast holes, we are probably less time efficient, but obviously the risk of skipping the blast is lower. Of course, we have also to consider many the other factors, like one drill rig or jumbo drill can be shared between several stopes. Cleaning speed also dependent on amount of rock that's crushed, and drilling performance can differ from stope to stope because of the resistant capacity of the rock. So there's no global solution, unfortunately. We have to use simulation every time, or almost every time, for each and every stope, or at least for each and every week of mining. So let's simulate, and what I'm going to show now is the system. That's the domain-specific user interface I've mentioned. You see that the mine plan is shown in a graphical editor. It can be edited in the point-and-click manner. For example, right now we can just correct mine node, and everything is there in the property views, like you have an AnyLogic, so the data input is protected from human errors, and you can, for example, you can change the properties of the of any equipment units, and all the data is organized in a tree here. For example, the ore passes, we can navigate between them, we can just copy the scenario, edit the parameters, and go ahead, launch the AnyLogic model, and it will automatically launch the AnyLogic model, and you're now seeing the 3D visualization of what's happening. That's the drill rig or jumbo drill. That did the roof bolting. It's now drilling the blast holes. So it's done drilling the blast holes, and it's okay. So that's a scoop tram going to take the ore out of there. I think we've already did the blast, so it's taking the ore down to the ore passes and dumps the ore there. That's the 3D visualization. Of course, it's a fancy one for stakeholders. And here, of course, everything is all the data is there in this dynamic tables. And of course, we also have charts of structure of the time of, in this case, of scoop trams and jumbo drills. That's just one small example of the analysis that we have inside the model. But still, so that's the. That's just to give you the comments, the sense of the system that we've implemented, and let's now go to the results. So our results shown that 3.2 meters is the best way is the best depth for this particular stope, and if we drill 3.2, we will be getting 4,600 tons of ore per month from this stope. And I'm not sure if you see it, but the table below has the explanation. The explanation is, as expected, if we drill deeper blast holes in this particular mine with this particular equipment, in this particular stope, if we drill deeper than 3.2, we start losing the blasts. The blast count here becomes less and less. So, and the four meters is the physical limit for this jumbo drill in this case. So I'm almost done. Let's come to the conclusion. Underground mine is a complex system with many constraints and interdependencies. I've given you some examples today. Simulation copes well with the complexity. The model we created replicates interactions between all types of movable equipment, as well as constant or continuous flows of ore coming through the conveyors and bunkers. And mine models require a lot of input data, especially that type of mine models, which is very detailed. They require a lot of input data that is hard to collect and even harder to maintain. To simplify using simulation on a regular basis by regular users, let's say mine planners, we have developed a tool consisting of AnyLogic model and this domain-specific user interface. It's actually acting as a single system, so it's inside a single application, so there's no there is no border between those two. And this tool is, we've already used it at two of our customers to support a wide, or to introduce to them a tool to support a wide range of decisions from daily operational scheduling to quantification of return of investment. And I've showed to you a couple of examples of how they do it. It's not us who do this. Thank you very much. I'm now done, and I'd be glad to answer questions, if any.
Hey, well, I'll just start off by saying thank you very much for the presentation. It was lovely to see something that was this intensive with this many pretty slides and videos. There's clearly a lot of complexity to the system that you're working on in terms of managing the data, managing structure, animations, movement, everything like that. How do you go about making sure that you haven't made a programming mistake in something of this scale? What are the testing methodologies that your company uses?
Yeah, thank you for your question. That's a really good one. Of course, just for the purposes of time, I skipped all the stuff about verification and validation, but that's actually regularly takes about 60% of the product's effort and project's effort and project's time. So what we do is several types of verification and validation. The first one being comparing to historical data, and so that's more or less evident and traditional. The second one is as the project is long, we just we set up. For example, we're now on the 16th of November. We set up the mine situation. We set up it exactly as it is now, and see what happens in a day, in a week, in actual mine, and look at all of the differences and try to explain them. And whether it's something extraordinary happened, which we shouldn't be modeling, okay, that's explained. Or we just skipping something important with which we should be modeling, and that's why we have this discrepancy between the modeled and actual data. So, and the final one is probably it's the first one in terms of the time. That's the unit testing, right? So we have to first make sure that every unit of the system, for example, drill rig or jumbo or dump truck, etc., is modeled properly.
How long did the model results marry with reality in the end of the day?
That's a good question about the verification and validation. So in this potash mine, we've able to reach the perfect match of between the simulated and actual data, and they're even using it to identify if something is going wrong in the mine when they see the actual results swaying from the simulated ones. In this nickel one, it was a it was more challenging to reach that, and we are still trying to finish the complete verification and validation. But for certain parts of the mine, we were able to reach probably. So if, in terms of the ore production, probably the discrepancy can be 1 to 3% on the weekly horizon. But that's, you know, but that's probably not the main objective to reach the perfect match. The main objective often is to verify or to justify how should we benefit from some operational improvements and from some investments. And in this respect, that's more important to compare as-is versus to-be scenario and to make sure that all the assumptions in both cases are the same.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.